and welcome to The World Beyond Belief. This is the fourth in our interview series. I am your co-host, Mindy Erkin. And with me today, as always, is your host, Paul Marco.
Hi, and welcome to The World Beyond Belief. Today, we welcome back to The World Beyond Belief, Ole Dammegard, a person that we always find enlightening, informative, but most of all, inspirational. Today, we talk about the weakening of the power of false flags and the power of the grand awakening now taking place on the planet. Let's welcome Ole to World Beyond Belief. Ole, how are you?
I'm very blessed, thank you.
Great.
And excited to be on the show again.
Well, thank you very much. We had a great response from the last time Zen Gardener posted it. We got a lot of great phone calls and a lot of great, not phone calls, we got a lot of great feedback on the interview. Well, how would you like to start today, Ole?
I have absolutely no idea, okay. So take it away.
Okay, well, we had, since we talked to you last, I think it was in early December, and we had a couple things happen. We had the Charlie Hebdo thing happen. I think it was a false flag in France, which is pretty close to you. You probably had some spillover down where you are. What else happened? Well, we've been encountering a lot of really positive things coming in the internet. I pulled up the internet this morning, and Lou Rutkowski, do you know who that is?
Yeah, I met him.
Lou Rutkowski posted a video on all the good things. You know, the fact that human beings are healthier now, homicides are down, and he had, maybe 25 different statistics. And we run into this all the time. Could be that we're on a positive timeline now. What do you think?
This is it. No, this is exactly it. I think it's such a wonderful time to be alive, because on one hand, it's very scary and challenging, and it looks totally horrible, and that the world is going under, the world is mad, and terrorists everywhere. On the other hand, it's just absolutely blossoming, and I think what we're watching is that the dragon has been slain, but the tail is just going all over the place, you know, like the last attempt to knock us down. But the thing is that we've joined in spirit on such a high level, you know, we've built ourselves up under so much pressure, and they have hit us with everything they've been able to, with diseases and fake viruses, vaccines, wars, terror acts, false flags, everything. They've tried everything, and we're still standing. So it's like, yahoo, wonderful.
Right. We're still evolving. It's still happening. The awakening is underway, no matter what they seem to do.
But the thing is, also, we have been so asleep. So apparently we have needed such extreme measures from their side to wake us up. So on a bit of a weird way of seeing it, we should be grateful to them as well, because I call them sometimes the black angels, that they are souls coming down here who have taken upon them to be really, really awful for us to wake up to the fact of how we should be, and they have put on themselves these, so I'm talking on a soul level,
right?
They have taken on a lot of negative karma on them to be this awful. So if you see it from a very high point of view, we should be grateful. But on this level, we should just totally transcend the obstacle. And I saw this beautiful message from a woman. I can't remember her name. I posted on my Facebook page today, Ole Dammegard on Facebook. And this was also this beautiful message to the elite saying, come on, guys, give it up. Give it up, you know, stop being the 1%. Instead of you 1% and 99% against you, let's become 100%, you know. There's a lot of anger and negative feelings from a lot of people against this morality, and for good reason. I mean, my God, they've been bashing us around for decades. And totally absorbed in greed and all of these very dark things. But the thing is, I would suggest to members of the so-called elite, or the minority as I call them, that one wonderful way of approaching us would say, listen guys, for one thing, in total transparency and with deep sincerity, from their hearts coming forward, asking for forgiveness for what they have done. And as a gift of, what do you call it? As a gift of reconciliation, offer us all these different free energy devices that they have put, you know, that they have stopped and stashed and whatever. All these beautiful, beautiful inventions that they have robbed and put away, so taken away from humanity. And also just by them stopping messing us up with HARP and chemtrails and withdraw all these awful vaccines, all of these things would be in a very beautiful gesture to put forward to humanity as a means to accomplish peace between us. So I think there's a middle way. Instead of them trying to win over us and totally control us, or we make a revolution and chop them up in small pieces and serve them on a pizza, neither of these are good options, but that would be a middle way, like a bridge building between, to say, we're very sorry, you know, we're very sorry, but here's a way that maybe we can meet and we can find a way of how to work side by side and come out on the other side of this in a healing feeling for the planet.
That's a beautiful thought. What do you think about, you know, if they're dark angels and they're putting us through a dilemma, they're putting us through problems so that we can overcome the problem.
Right.
Understatement. What about the people who still aren't coming around, that they have to get harder and harder on in order for them to wake up? I think there's a lot of people who really like the Matrix, that are really enjoying it right now. Think they need to keep going, or?
I'm not sure which people you're talking about, the people asleep or the people who are duping us.
The people asleep.
Asleep, it's nice to be asleep, you know. You can just lie on the sofa, pull the curtain over your head or the blanket over your head and just stick your head in the sand.
Right.
It's a nice feeling, but at the same time, it's not really like that either. You know, it's a very closed in, with walls of concrete around you, not giving you a lot of space to move around.
Right.
So, but I also think that we have to be gentle on ourselves, because we're up against the most advanced propaganda machine that the world has ever seen, the most covert operations, the most advanced mind control techniques, whatever they have, they've tried on us, or they're doing it to us. I mean, I know a lot of people who are being attacked in different ways, technically or mentally.
Right.
Or, you know, it's like it's like being up against Mike Tyson sometimes.
Right.
So let's just pat ourselves on the back and say, listen, we have been so duped, and no wonder why, because we've been up against this incredible propaganda machine that nobody has actually, or very few have been able to even spot that it's there. So, and also it's painful to wake up, to see that, oh my God, all of these things that I learned, all of these things that I stood up and defended, all of these things that I attacked other people because of, or criticized other people because of, and then it turns out that they're absolute lies.
Right.
It is a shaking experience, and for me as well, in some areas where I thought I know about, like for instance, the Second World War, I know a lot of the historical so-called facts, and now, in that area as well, I just had to totally reteach myself, because apparently we have been totally duped there as well. So many different areas.
Exactly. We're just, we heard an interview by someone named Eric Carlstrom. He was on Red Ice Radio, and he's done a lot of research in the New Age movement, especially in Colorado. Every one of those New Age teachings, I think I was involved with. You know, I was involved with the the Course in Miracles and this and that and the other thing. As it turns out, they're mostly weaponized tools of influence. So to pull out the good from those teachings and separate it from the propaganda and the corruption involved was a real eye-opener for Mindy and I lately, reading through and finding out how they're using this to create a new one-world religion. As you were saying, it's hard to wake up because it's one bump after another, you know, boom, here. Oh, that's not true anymore. Oh, yeah, it's an amazing ride, isn't it?
It is. When people like they like horror movies, they like going to the carnivals, the roller coasters and so on. So welcome, here's a real one for you.
Right, here's a real one for you. More real than you even want it to be.
But this whole new age thing, I think you have to look at old age as well. It's old age teaching.
Right.
Because these are the ones with a lot of truth in it. And I would say, Course in Miracles, I mean, the message, the basic message, absolutely beautiful. It's what you do with it.
Exactly.
If it's used to tranquilize the population, then it's the wrong thing. But it's like in the beginning of this book, Jesus said, listen, if you're up for it, I can put it down in two sentences. There's love and there's fear. That's it. If you get that, love is real, fear is not.
Right.
You get that, then we can stop here. But then we're so thick, so we needed like another 1,000 pages for him to repeat it and repeat it and repeat it. So the whole basic thing is, love is real, fear is not. So wherever fear comes into your life, it's not real. It's like a shadow thing that tries to scare you into all kinds of weird stuff. So this is why I always focus on love, to get the vibration up there so that fear cannot reach.
You know? Right.
Because that is... This is why they're trying to push us down so much all the time, because they're so aware. They want us down in the dirt, head down in there, you know, with a boot on top of our skull,
right,
so that we can't look up and see what's going on. Because as long as since they're on a low vibration, because they're so much into violence and these very dark things, brutal, brutal forces, as long as they can keep us under, they got us. But if we race above it, they can't reach us. This is the wonderful thing. And maybe I'm totally hallucinating, and maybe they can get me, but I feel quite safe where I am compared to where I used to be when I was scared and when I was paranoid and so on. Because that was where they could get me, you know, by the stroke and control. And so I really think that like Jesus, Buddha, Muhammad, these type of people were normally, I describe them as super hackers. They cracked the code. They got it of what is in this matrix. And the basic rule is that a higher energy, a lower energy will be annulled in the presence of a higher energy. It just disappears. And you can see this in laboratory tests as well. The two meet and boom, the lower one disappears. And it's the same with these dark forces. If we keep a higher, when they enter, if we don't let them enter, they go away. They can look very scary for a long time. And the closer you get into it, but if you don't buy into it, it disappears. Like some kind of miracle thing happened. And I'm sure most people have been in situations like that where they've been, and then it just goes away. And afterwards you're like, I'm not really sure what happened, but it went away. But if you go into fear mode, then the chances of you getting hurt or controlled is so much bigger.
Yeah, I think that's most of the people that are like in your position, who are really having an influence, and could really, the matrix control system could really benefit from your not being there. They don't seem to be able to get near you. You know, if I'm going to mention Zen Gardner again, he's another one. He seems immune, and I think it's probably because he's using the same technique. Not that it's a technique, it sounds like a cheap technique. No, it's not a technique. It's a method of putting yourself beyond the reach of the fear merchants. Is that what you say? Putting yourself.
I say if I'm wrong, at least I'm going to die happier.
Right.
And if I'm right, I'm going to stay safe. But I feel in my heart that this is the way to go, whatever the consequences. And I think also when you see, you have to have a feeling for what you're up against. When you see people like, beautiful people like Martin Luther King and so on, what he did, I would say, as a mistake, was he kept pushing. And I believe that there is a thing, you know, like you can do an experiment. If you put up your hand like this, and you say to someone else, put up your hand against mine, and you start pushing, that the normal reaction will be to push back instead right. of just letting go. You know, you're not really doing anything. You're just putting your hands together, and you start pushing, and the other one will start push back right away. And this is a normal reaction from, I say, maybe someone on a lower frequency right. is to push back. And these people, if you push them, they will get back. They will knock you off. And this is where I've tried so far, I've been successful, is to push, and then when I feel, whoa, I'm getting too close, then I back off. And then I wait. And then I start pushing again. And then because I've been threatened, you know, and they try to scare me off.
I didn't know that.
And it's very scary, I mean, because they're it's not a game, you know, they really want to hurt you and get rid of you, so it's a scary thing to do, but when you push and then relax, let it go, and then forward, but with feeling, you know, and then when you feel, whoops, I'm getting too close, take a step back, it's a that so far has been a good way for me. And Fen, which I'm very proud to call him my friend, is on a similar path, I think, absolutely beautiful person, and the way also that he approaches the thing, because he's also, I mean, all of us who are trying to make a difference, we are a target, you know, and we are the people that they would love to label terrorists, but they're getting there, they're not far away. So.
Well, they're not there, though. They're not there, you know. They can do the suicide thing. They can do a lot of things, but they don't seem to be able to touch people who stay in love, stay in the positive vibration, and don't think about or concentrate on the dark side.
I hope so. I hope so. Paul. That is my intention. That see how it goes.
Right. It seems. You know, if you look at the mainstream media and even the alternative media, it really looks like they have all the control system has all the mechanisms and all the mind and the ELF waves and the military vehicles and the control of this media and that. But you know, there must be love must be at least an equal force for them to be so worried about it, for them to be so. I mean, they're building fortresses I can't even imagine. You know, fortresses in terms of military interventions and things. We must be pretty damn powerful as a human consciousness awakening.
Love is, I mean, the difference in power you cannot even measure. Love is the power. What they're coming with is just like a big fart, you know. It smells and it looks very awful when it comes through the air.
Right.
But the thing is, they cannot love. They have no chance against, and that is why what they fear as well. Love and truth. These are the two ones, and I think they go totally together. And it's like they say, truth, fear, no investigation. You know, there's. It's so clean. It's so pure. It's so focused. Like razor sharp, and then if you add gentleness to it, it's because honesty without kindness, that is no good either. It needs to be served in a gentle way, in a loving way. Then there's no stopping of it.
That's beautiful. Well, very well put. So, have you been paying attention to the news at all? I'm not sure whether you do that. But we've been seeing a lot of positive things coming out of Russia.
I tell you, for me, there's so much going on, and I need to focus somewhere, and I haven't focused at all on Russia or China or anything, because I just get schizophrenic. My brain just, there's too much overload. And so I focus on my parts. I focus on the Paris thing, which is just like you say, absolute false flag. I'd be happy to go into some details that can just, for people who doubt it, I can just go into some, just show what really happened and so on. And but the other parts, I lead to other people who are more focused in those areas and more passionate about that.
I think you're exactly right. It's very difficult to keep up to date on everything, especially since you don't know what's really news or really happening. I mean, we're just taking people's word for it. So, yeah, it would be really, really helpful for all of us if you give us your take on the Paris Charlie Hebdo thing, Ole.
Okay, the thing is that I've done this for some 30 years. And I worked as a background actor on many film sets when I don't know if I mentioned, but two of my friends was murdered in Sweden because we got too close to the truth of the assassination of Olof Palme.
No.
And I was threatened as well, so we left Sweden partly due to this. And so we moved to Spain with absolutely nothing, and I started working. I did everything I could, different types of works and so on. And one of them was being a background actor, one of these people walking in the background.
Right.
So I'm really good at doing that. I can walk from point A to point B without falling over and chewing at the same time.
Talented.
I can play against Daniel Craig, you know, the James Bond now.
Yeah.
In the background. Anyway, so one of the things that I did when I, because the, you know, on film sets, it's incredibly time consuming. So that you as an extra have to be there 5 o'clock in the morning to late in the evening and so on, just hang around doing absolute zero.
Yeah.
So what I thought was, instead of just hanging around, I'm going to see if I can learn as much as possible. So I was walking around, asking questions, you know, looking into equipment and whatever they were doing there, because, and helping it, you know, like help set up the whatever, you know, makeup or staging the light or right. Microphones or everything. And this has come in very, very handy because these false flag operations are fit like film sets, you know, the staged events that are being filmed to be pumped out in media to get the reaction from us, that reaction,
right.
Emotional one. We're freaking out here, please help us, and then they will serve us the solution. It's the old Roman problem, reaction, solution, the one they always use. So, when you look at a thing like this, or when I look at it, I try to come with an open mind, and then I start looking for the signs. What is real, what is not? Because, like we said before, truth doesn't fear any investigation. And what happened, if it really happened, there would not be question marks. It just happened, you know?
Right.
So here we look at it. And, for instance, the film I think most people have seen is like this car stopping, two so-called terrorists jumps out of the car, runs over, they shot down a police officer, he's rolling around on the pavement. And one of them run by and fires a headshot with an AK-47 right into the head of this guy, police officer, then run back into the car and take off. Awful. Awful. If it really happened. So this is where I go in and try to break it up and see, okay, could it be a film set? Are there any signs of that this could be a filmed event? And also, it's very important to keep in mind that when they do this, they film it, and then afterwards they add sound effects, they add background sound,
that's
sound,
right.
All of these things, you know. So we look at this one, and one of the things, when there's vehicles involved, or if it's in a city, the producers of the film or the commercial, they have to approach the local authorities, get the permission to close off the streets, because they need total control over pedestrians, vehicles, everything. So that, for instance, if you are like one of, if I had been there as a background thing, they would say, okay, we mark it, we put a cue marker here, that's point A. When we shout background action, you start walking from point A, and we're going to put a marker over there, that's point B. So they always start background action first, and then action, so that there's no strange movement in the background. The background all has to be smooth. And also there needs to be continuity so that they can edit it afterwards, so that then when they cut together the different angles, the background action will still be the same. So in my case, dear Mr. Bellador, you stand point A, and when we shout background action, you start walking there. Do not look into the camera. This is one thing. You must not look into the camera. When you look at these stage events, they would look everywhere else but into the camera. They've been told that, you know, because
right.
If they look straight to the camera, it's a retake. They have to redo it. Okay. So point A to point B. And you look at all the different events in Paris, the streets were closed off. There was no other traffic, absolutely no one. There were no pedestrians, nothing. Okay. Then you have, also when the vehicles involved, you put markers where the vehicle should stop or, you know, things, just so it would be the same because of angles for the camera.
Yeah, so, camera angle.
And sometimes in films you can see, if they had like in an action movie and the car does have to do sliding around like that, you will see on the road when they film it that there's like several skid marks where they do the skid marks because they've already
right.
trained it a couple of times before that. So these are the signs to check out. Okay, here in this case you have a black line exactly centered under the car where the car has stopped. And up to the right of the car there's a trainer in the car. So you got the width and length, sort of like a coordinate stop here. Okay, so that the train and the shoe in the street could be a coincidence, but this guy, both of them had shoes on, so this shoe was extra, and the terrorist, or so-called terrorist on the passenger side, picked it up, threw it in the car, and before they took off. So it belonged to them. Why was it there? I would say to mark the position, boom. Because that is where the angle for the photographer up on the balcony to get it. You would also see that the camera movements are very steady. First, they shake it like this to make it authentic. You're, oh
right.
my God, it's a mobile. But then the whole movement around is very smooth, and like a panoramic angle.
Right, panoramic.
Like and then you will see also when they start running, there's white markers on the pavement where he runs up, where he stops or turns on the pavement, and where he turns around going back to the three white markers.
Wow.
So then you have this chrome side mirrors on this car. And as far as I've been able to track out, this was a Citroën C3 from 2014. Then the car that was found later, abandoned, had black side mirrors and was a Citroën C3 2013. Not the same car. And this is where they found the so-called ID.
Passport.
Yeah. No, it wasn't a passport, it was like this is the whole thing. I mean, I'm here, I'm on a suicide mission, and what should I remember? My gun, my mask, my whatever. Yeah, I mustn't forget my driver's license.
Right.
And I won't put it in my wallet. I will take it out of my wallet and put it in the back seat, so they will find. I mean, come on.
That's crazy.
The same with the passport in 9/11.
That's crazy. What about the shot, Ollie? Did you get to study the shot, the AK-47 shot? Are we still on?
Now, if you've been to war zones, if there's suddenly people start shooting, the normal reaction is that people start screaming or running away, or they do not continue to love them. If you listen to the sound, the laughter continues, even after the shots are fired. I would say added background sound. The film, the effect of the shots, very powerful. They've done a great job there, because it's the sound of the shots that are flying between walls. It's very echoey, you know, very,
right.
It has a massive impact. There's no building on the other side, so I would say that shot, the sound is somewhat added for amplifying. That is at least my suggestion. Okay, so you have these two guys, they run, go out of the car, they shot the police officer. He's rolling around on the pavement. Okay? Apparently he's been hit. Now the normal thing for a human being, if you start bleeding, you will put your hands on the wound. It's an automatic reaction.
Right.
When this guy, he's apparently hit in the leg or something like that. But then when the so-called terrorist approaches, he puts up his hands like this. No blood on his hands. Okay. Then the guy runs by him. We're talking about an AK-47. That is a very powerful automatic weapon. Yeah. There's no recoil whatsoever when he fires the shot. And when you look at it, there's been discussions that it was a blank fire. I would say absolutely not, because you don't fire a blank off right at that distance in the face of someone.
Right.
At least not if it's a stage in it. But if you see that it looks like there's a ricochet in the pavement, but it's not. If you zoom in and you slow it down, you will see that the police officer has like a small little smoke canister in his left hand. He turns around and it explodes upwards and to the right in a right angle. The smoke comes from his hand, not from the gun. So it's just an added thing, added effect to the whole thing. Then, also they're very relaxed. If you've been to war zones or where people are really shooting, there's a lot of tension and adrenaline in the air. You know, people are tensed and scared and pumped. Here they run around like they were so relaxed, you know. He doesn't check if the guy was hit. There's no impact whatsoever on the skull. And I tell you, if you've seen a headshot, oh my God, it's awful, awful. No blood on the pavement, no impact, you know, like no concrete blown away or anything like that. Absolutely not a shot fired. Then the car takes off. Does it go with like screaming tires? No, they drive off. No, let's go shopping.
Let's go shopping.
And you have the whole camera. When first it shakes, then it follows, and then when it goes back to the lift, you will see that it films a bit of the wall on the balcony, whatever you call that. And I would very much say that if this had been a free camera, it's said to be a GoPro. You listen to this GoPro camera, because they've started. It's almost like they're making commercials for the GoPro. When all of these terrorist things come up, I'll get back to that. Either a GoPro camera or a mobile camera. As far as I've been able to find out, he was using a GoPro. And it's a very, you can do like this with it. But here, it's like, if you ever try to film with a camera stand and you have to go up and to the left, you're stuck sort of. So the camera moves like this and like this. It moves exactly like if it was on a stand. So forget about the shaking to start with, see what the rest of it, okay? Then the car takes off, and before that it encountered another police car. Apparently, somehow, the rear window had been shot out on this car. It was crashed. So you have this image where he meets the police car, totally empty street again. They meet like almost like this front to front. And the police car starts reversing, and they start firing, blah, 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 like this. So we got all these still photos where the police car has come reversed so fast that it went across the street and just smashed into a parked car. You look at the photos, you look at the dent in the police car. The dent is very high up the car that is supposed to have hit right into the side of, it does nothing there that could do that damage, you know. And the car that is supposed to have hammered into is not dented at all, but the front wheel is totally, you know, like dislocated. So how did that happen? I would say they take like scrap cars, they put them together, you know, like they come with tow trucks, put them down, like they stage the whole thing. Then you have the car continues, and then they abandon the car. Somebody has filmed the thing from taking a photo from a rooftop, abandoned car. The rear mirror suddenly, the rear window suddenly, it's not crashed anymore. And then you got the black side mirrors, and then also it stands there open doors. Look at the two pedestrian crossings, and also look at the window, the colors of the window shields, and what do you call it, the window, the names of the bars and the shops and so on. And also the distance to the pedestrian crossing, the zebra crossing. The one that is taking the photo from above is the one where the chrome side mirrors, and it's like 1.50 meters from the pedestrian crossing. Then you look at the black one with the black side mirrors. That one, when you see the photos taken on that one, it's standing next to the other pedestrian crossing and a lot closer. So it's almost, I believe that maybe they had both vehicles there at the same time, so they had the abandoned one, took a photo, and then a tow truck came and put the other one down, and they drew them up next to each other, you know, and the other one took off. So it looks like they've been parked next to each other when you check the distance. Okay, then you have, that is the one where the ID has been prepared, right. The evidence and all these things. And that's the thing, the only thing that connected and tracked down these two brothers was the ID that was so conveniently forgotten in the car.
Right.
I would say also that when you look at the police interrupting, I go rambling.
What?
Or should I continue?
Oh, yeah, continue. I'm fascinated with this. I think that...
Should I continue?
Yes. You can, with your background in investigating the murder of the Swedish president, and also with your background investigating the Kennedy assassination, which was so incredible, just your almost casual look at this can throw out so much information. It's amazing to me. Yeah, continue. I love it. If you want to.
No, what I do is instead of having a theory about things, instead of having a theory about things, I try to get the facts together and then build a case on that. So, okay, you have this thing that apparently these two brothers were very, very upset because this cartoon was made, you know, making jokes of Muslims. I would say, don't you think that like thousands of Muslim children being killed in Afghanistan and Iraq and these type of things would upset them more,
right,
than a cartoon? Just a little remark. No, but apparently they got so pissed off when they saw this one. So what they did was they dressed up as terrorists and they said, we're going to go and kill a lot of people here. So who are we going to kill? Well, we're going to kill the people who made the drawing. So did they know where the office was? No. But they knew where a woman that worked at the office was using as a daycare center. So what they did was they stalked her. How did they know where her daycare center was if they didn't even know where the newspaper was? But apparently they kidnapped her when she was there to pick up a child to go to the meeting at the newspaper. Don't you normally drop off your child when you go to a meeting? I would say no, but here she picked him up and then he disappears from the timeline. Anyway, so then they have her show them where the newspaper is. I mean, go figure. Wouldn't that be an idea maybe to check the phone book and just say, oh, that's the address, let's go there. No, they stalk this woman, kidnap her, and then she helps them to let them in there. Unfortunately, it was guarded because it had been threatened before,
sure,
this newspaper. But these guards, I don't know what happened to them. Some reports say that they were shot. Other reports say that they were not there. I don't know. So they go in there. They start shooting everybody, and the whole thing, Allah Akbar, and we're here from ISIS or whatever. Come on, make right up some better line. But it's the same thing, Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar. So they do that whole thing, and then the whole place is shut up. Loads of people killed. Have you seen any photos? No, very sorry. We don't show these photos because of concern for the families. But if you look at the crime scene, okay, the only photos that I've been able to see is, like, there's a big blood pool on the floor with a chair standing on it, there are bullet holes in the walls and so on. If you see a real crime scene, it's an awful sight, really, really. And especially when somebody has been afraid of being shot and tried to escape, they often try, they go, either they hide on the furniture or they try to get away, you know, along the wall. And then when shots are fired, they're thrown up against the wall. And very often blood is being, there's a splash pattern. And also,
right,
like these, when people slide down, these type of patterns on the wall. It looks horrific. Here, absolutely nothing. Also, the color of blood, depending on where in the body the wound is, depending how much oxygen there is in the body, the color of the blood is very different. It can be almost pinkish, and it can be quite dark. Here, on all these photos, like, we've got like bright red, like ketchup, let's get in 4 more pounds of ketchup and splash it around. It's theater blood. It's very, very red. And it stays red. It stays this incredibly red color. Normally, you know, when blood, if you cut yourself, it goes brown within quite fast. Here, it stays brown. Red. Then you have this, the chair that is put on top of this puddle of blood. There's absolutely no blood on it. There's no blood stains, there's no nothing. It's just put on top of it. And the detectives, real detective, would never put furniture on top of evidence.
No.
So, and you can see that the chair has been sliding around in the blood, but there's no blood on it at all. And then next to it, there's a bag, very nice bag, that says Puma. I would just say, maybe I'm taking this too far, but when you look at the people we're talking about, they're very much into business and cynical, you know, no empathy whatsoever. Here's something, there's a bag next to the pool. This is a photo that millions and millions of people will look at, and it says Puma, the bag Puma. Then you got the GoPro camera. For a lot of these false flag operations, they say that now the terrorist's new tool is the GoPro camera. I mean, that there are quite a few different labels when it comes to action cameras and so on. But it's the GoPro, all the time, GoPro camera. Then you have Puma. Then you have, when you go down, if you use Google Map, you go down to the street level where the police officer was shot. You start turning around and twisting around. One of the things, right where on the pavement where this police officer was supposed to have been shot, there was a big truck, and on the side of it, it looked like Photoshopped in, rent a car with a big website address. In English, we're in France. do you see what I'm saying? Then you have the car that they lifted off, you know, the police came. The crime scene detectives, all of these and white things, you know,
right,
plastic bags, it's so authentic, my God, we're so serious. And so they lift this car up, it is so polished, it's like a showroom example of a Citroën C3 that would be spread all over the world.
Right.
Am I making this up? I don't know, but it's like, I can't remember what it is they say in the film industry. They call it, you know, like when you see
product placement.
Beer, and so, then suddenly you see, oh, Heineken. And
yeah, they call it product placement.
Sorry?
They call it product placement. Like product placement.
That's the one.
That's when the policeman will be drinking
a
Coke. So that you can see there's Coca-Cola and Citron and GoPro and Puma. Jeez. They don't miss a trick. It's amazing. It's amazing.
And then you have, when these terrorists were in there shooting all of these people, that whole street was totally empty. No pedestrians, no nothing. It was only in the middle of the day in Paris. I mean, go figure.
Right.
And then you have these people that are hiding up on top of a building. Somebody is filming it. I'm sure he filmed it maybe with a GoPro camera. And you see this empty street down there, and people are hiding. Oh my God, what's going on down there? It's only like 20 meters up in the air. Why would you even hide? But they're up there hiding behind a wall. Okay. Then you slow it down, you go in slow motion mode, and you check out. And suddenly, two of the people have bulletproof vests on. Very handy when they went to the office that morning.
Right.
So they both, one has got a blue shirt, a very official looking shirt, and a big black bulletproof vest. And then over to the left, one of the guys that run across the rooftop, bulletproof vest. You look down in the street. The official story is that the terrorist came and then the police followed. You look here. For one thing, when the camera goes over, if you go into slow motion, suddenly you see it's spliced together. It's two different takes that they put together. It jumps like this. And then you see down on the street, there are three people running like this. Black clothes and white takes on the back, you know. And as far as I've been able to say, it says police. So you got three police officers running in the street, very dramatic. And then after them come two terrorists. And the story, the timeline says it was the other way around. Sloppy.
Yeah, sloppy.
Then you have this whole kosher thing. I love that one. You suddenly have somebody else who's taking these hostages. And we're back to nowadays with Patsies, it's Muslims and poor black people. I mean, that's the thing they hear
right.
Again and again and again and again. It used to be Russians and East Germans in the Cold War, now Muslims and black folks. Here, once again, I also want to say that the two brothers that were in there shooting all of these people, one of the witnesses said that he had very, very cold blue eyes. You look at the eye color of these two brothers, brown eyes. So it's not even, sorry again, sloppy. Okay, then you have this whole kosher thing where they take a hostage. Oh my God, it's so awful. There's all these terrorist things going on in Paris at the same time. They don't even know if they're connected. But my God, let's get 1,000 people over there. And how many robocops did we see in black outfits? I mean, holy macaroni, there are people all over the place. So you've got these people in there. You've got loads of SWAT team, black dressed outside. And there's a lot of commotion going on, shooting and things like that. A bomb goes off, very dramatic. And then, have you seen, I think it's called Oh, What a Party with Peter Sellers. Have you seen that one? Very Num Num, that film.
Yeah, I've seen, I think it's called The Party, Peter Sellers. It's hilarious. Yeah. Go ahead.
The Party, that's the one. The Party,
yeah.
Yeah, and in the beginning, he's an extra on film sets, and he managed to blow up a massive big fortress because he's just, he gets too much into it, and he doesn't know what he's doing. Very not good. Here we got another one. Here comes Peter Sellers, but in a modern version.
Right.
You got this whole team of a SWAT team. They're standing next to the doors. You know, they're hiding, on the other side of window glass. I mean, that's a very good place to hide. if they got somebody armed on the other side, I would say.
Right, yeah.
But they're standing there really on the door sides. So they're really in the bombs going off and all of these things. And then you got this guy, he comes behind a black car and jumps out in front of it and starts firing with his automatic, whatever it is he's got, I don't know what weapon it is, but it's automatic fire, right into the crowd of police officers, in the back of the police officers. You know, we're talking blanks here, and somebody who right. does not know what he's doing. I would say many of these people in these uniforms were not police officers at all. A SWAT team would never do a thing like that. Never, ever. And can I also just point out that, do you know when SWAT teams came around? It was the first mass shooting, it was in 69, I think, or something like that, in Texas. Where else? There was this military guy who just thought that I'm going to take a lot of weapons and I'm going to go up into a tower at a university I can't remember where it was, one of these, Houston, I think.
Yeah, I think it was.
There was this high tower up there. And he managed to bring up, I don't know how many weapons and tools. He even brought a compass. That's really good when you're up in a tower.
Right,
you want to shoot people.
Yeah.
He had a compass and a flashlight and an axe and I don't know how many weapons and things like that. He brought that up, started shooting. Witnesses saw that at times there were being shots fired in multiple directions at the same time. Then this guy ends up dead. He commits suicide. Sounds familiar. And after that, they said, oh my God, we need an anti-terrorist unit, a SWAT team that can act in these situations. That was the first SWAT team, and then it has just continued. Problem, reaction,
solution.
For your protection, they stage an event, come to get the reaction, oh my God, and then there was a solution. Now there are Robocops everywhere. You know?
That's right.
So, just a little remark.
Well, we know.
So, what do you think, Paul? Was this a real event in Paris, or was it not?
Well, I think that the big telling thing for me, I'm not a real analyst like you are, but the big thing for me was everybody showed up with a Just Sweet Charlie sign almost immediately. And, you know, they were well-made signs. They were designed. They all looked alike, and everyone had one. It was like, where did that come from? You know?
But, very good observation. Very, very good, because you will see it's the same font, it's the same background on many of these signs. It's a slogan, you know? And it's not a French, they even put in Charlie so that it went international, so that because it would have been, Je suis pour vous.
Yeah, that's right.
It needs to be an international goal, you know. So it's almost, you know, like they're almost making a jingle in the background.
Right.
This type of thing. Yeah, that's the one. Go for that one. And
yeah,
it's all prepared. And I also would say that there was a lot of build-up of military presence in Paris earlier.
Right.
I think there was about 30,000 soldiers. They were withdrawn, and then this thing happened, and suddenly you have the streets filled with people. If you take 30,000 soldiers and put them in civilian clothes, what would that look like in the streets of Paris?
Exactly.
A whole movement.
That's right. You know, it seems like...
Yeah.
It's only,
have these world leaders. Oh.
Well, it seems like that they're orchestrating not just the problem anymore. They're orchestrating the problem and the reaction. So they had the reaction all in place, too. They had the Just We Charlie and the slogans and everything in place. Yeah, and then in comes the what I call the March of the Puppets. All these puppet leaders, Netanyahu, the woman from Germany, French leader. I mean, they were all there, all lined up, shoulder to shoulder, you know.
But this is such a good observation that you made there, because they need to control it, you know, especially nowadays when they're getting, we're waking up on such a rate, so they need to control every single step of it. including the reaction. So very good observation, I would say. And if you look at the solution is part of the crime. So the people that came right. as a solution was part of creating it. So very, very interesting to see who were these people that was lined up there. And also, you see these photos where they're so brave, they walk right in the front line, you know, side by side against terrorism, and then loads of people behind them. No, actually not. When you see an aerial photo of when they took that shot, the streets were closed off because these people are incredible cowards.
Oh, there's not, cool.
They haven't got a backbone anywhere in them. And then you look, there's only like a few lines of people, like maybe a 30, 40, 100 maybe behind them, but put in a way so that when you take the photo in a street level, it looks like the whole street is filled up.
Right.
We're back to the illusion. They're serving us illusions.
Right.
And can I, if, talking about illusions, do you know what I found? After the Paris thing, in this kosher shop, they had a criminal investigation of the site, and there were lots of photos being spread where this technical team went in and checked out. And especially there's a series of photos of a guy in an orange plastic suit with a mask, and he's behind a window that has been blown in and so on. I thought that image looks pretty familiar somewhere, so I started seeing where I had seen it. At the NAACP bombings in Colorado, just a week before, the exact same photos were used.
Right, exactly.
And then, you know, the Peshawar shooting, the mass shooting in Pakistan in Peshawar on the 21st of December, awful thing again. All of these children were being shot. Oh my God, it's awful, it's awful, it's awful. Solution, we have to execute at least 500 terrorists. We look at it, you go into the school, same thing. The whole school is shot up, all, you know, bullet holes everywhere. Very red blood. Days afterwards, on the floor, the blood is still red. Incredible.
Incredible.
And then you have all these victims. I started looking at the victims. Who was one of the victims? Come on, people, sloppy. One of the victims was Noah Posner.
Yeah.
One of the victims from Sandy Hook. And I thought first, they photoshopped this in to make people like me get going and then be exposed like a fraud or something like that.
Uh-huh.
But here, I've collected loads of different photos and Noah Posner is in all of them, including one take from the BBC where this female reporter walks up along the wall saying, you can see the flowers and the candles and the families in the background. She said, oh, this tragic day, another blah, 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 blah. It's so awful, it's so awful, it's so awful. And she just passes the photo of Noah Posner on the wall.
You know, that goes way beyond sloppy. I mean, it's way beyond sloppy. It sounds like they're really putting things in. It's like almost like your product placement stuff. You know, they put these ringers in.
I don't know. Either they're totally so not good at what they're doing, or it's just right there to get us going for some reason. Or then you have the Toronto shooting, the Ottawa shooting, same thing, sloppy, sloppy, and the Sydney one. I can go into a little detail about the Ottawa, but it's up to you.
Oh, go ahead. Yeah, this is fascinating me because what we're finding out here is that for some reason, these false flag events, narrated black swans, we called them in a video we just made, are showing up everywhere, and people are debugging them almost immediately because of this sloppiness. Now, it's either arrogance, what do they call it, hubris. It's either that, or, like you said in the beginning, maybe if the idea is to wake us up, maybe the idea is to wake us up, to give guys like you, who see through it immediately, credibility. I mean, nobody could dispute that Noah Posner's photograph is in Pakistan. I mean, it's like the same photograph they used in Sandy Hook. It's not like a different photograph of the kid.
Yeah,
So what do you think? What do you think? Tell me about Ottawa, because these are. It looks like the thing is falling apart.
What I would say, without bragging, is that people like myself have been trying to expose the methods, the templates, for years and years.
Right.
And I know, once again, without bragging, I know that I've been heard of at least by a million people who have heard about these templates, who have heard about the methods, and hopefully they have told their families, they have informed themselves and started looking at it. After the Boston bombing as well, there was an incredible increase in people searching for the word false flag on Google and so on. So after Boston, it was like they made a major mistake. That was the tipping point when people's like, whoa, this is, you know. So Boston, Sandy Hook, these type of things have just destroyed it for them, because before that they got away with it, but this was just over the top. And so it's wonderful that so many people are so aware and so awake, because now they can hardly move without being observed.
Right, right.
It's wonderful.
Say a little bit more about the template. I remember that from your Red Ice interview. It was amazing because you had identified a template that they use over and over and over again. We know that their species is not creative. We know that the whatever this force is doesn't seem to be creative, and that they use the same thing over and over again. And you talked about on that interview a little bit about isolating this template, that they always do this and then they always do that. You want to talk a little bit about that, Ole?
Yeah, for sure. It's like, it's not a template I found or I've seen on paper or
no.
Anything like that. It's just by looking so deeply into so many of these ones that I found that, oh my God, they're doing it again. There's a very, very clear pattern of how they pull this off. So, what do you want, assassination or a terror act? They're quite similar, but...
Go ahead, either one, just to show the idea that they use the same thing over.
Okay, let's go for the terror act, because there are more of these going on at the moment. There are not so many assassinations. It's more. Okay, so if I'm the one in power, so-called power, in the old days, for instance, in Latin America and so on, when they made a military coup, They had the CIA backing up, you know, funding the whole thing. They got some rogue elements in the army and funded them and so on, equipped them with weapons, and very quickly took over. They went in, they killed the president, Allende, or whoever the name was. They got rid of the people in power position, and overnight, boom, they were in this power position of the country. But that was good, but it was only the beginning of a lot of problems, because when people woke up the next morning, starting to understand that they suddenly had a dictator ruling the country, you had all kinds of problems with underground movements, guerrillas, demonstrations. So what they had to do was mass arrest people in the thousands to try and get hold of everyone that was against them. They had to fill the football stadiums, the prison. They had to torture them to say, where are all your friends? Where are they hiding? You know, very, very messy. And in the end, it was almost like they needed as many police officers and soldiers as there were people in the population. And every single one they executed, they had problems with their families and mothers, so they had to kill them as well. And then their relatives were getting very difficult. So they learned from that one, and I think they went back and said, listen, we got to get back in line and go do what the Romans did, because they knew, they've done it, they knew what they were up to. So like, the ones that they really love, the only one they have more or less, I think they only got that one, is problem, reaction, solution. They have a very, if, let's say that I'm the one, the president of a country, and what I want is, I want the police that are now very nice and calm and friendly, I want them to turn into total robocops.
Right.
I want them to drive around in tanks with the supers. I want them to have helicopters and drones and be able to blow up anyone at any time, kick in doors, you name it. I had the possibility, I could just order the police to do that and the military. It wouldn't be a problem, but then I would have all this, all of these reactions and all of this mess. So what I need is, I need a problem for the people to welcome my solution. So it needs to be the same magnitude of problem as the solution I want to present. So what I do is, one of their favorites, they love bombs, they love, it needs to be drama, you know, because right. We're talking about film things, because they need the impact in media. So they love bombs, mass shootings, and they go for the emotional thing. So what they focus on is trying to kill women, children,
yeah.
And also in the aftermath of these things, they want nuns, nurses, doctors, and even better, if they can kill nurses or infect them with viruses or something like that, it really hits home, you know.
Yeah.
It doesn't work with guys like you and me if they blow us up or some old cows or a tractor somewhere. It doesn't make the impact, women and children. So they would, what they do is, I would find the perfect spot for this to happen. It needs to be in a central location where lots of people are moving, so that even though I don't blow them up, they will, from that day on, oh my God, it could have been me. You know, I was only 20 minutes from, you know, I was there 2 hours before. Then you can include the whole population or a lot more people. So what you do is you aim at a, like it could be a shopping center, a train station, a big building, and they want daycare centers, or they want these type of things, like in Oklahoma, so that they get their children, or Sandy Hook schools, perfect, you know, women, children, teachers, female teachers, beautiful children. Okay, so what I do is I make a drill. They always, more or less, always have a drill going on with the exact same scenario. And the reason for that, as far as I've been able to understand, is that that will allow them to get strange vehicles in position, you know, bombs, bomb cars. I can do the patsy to get in position. I can get the whole thing set up because it's a drill. Nobody really reacts, oh, they're filming a Coca-Cola shoot, or is it a drill shoot? I don't know, but something is going on and nobody really notices it until suddenly the drill goes live. So there's this drill.
Hello, we're still here. We were talking about when the Skype just cut out. You were talking about the template and getting a lot of people together, and they've always focused in on women and children to make it more dramatic, and you were going through that whole thing.
It's really disgusting.
It is really disgusting.
What they do is, at the same time as I get the bomb and everything in place, I prepare a patsy. It needs to be somebody that works in media, some group or individual that looks weird or looks like a Muslim. Black people also have been misused as patsies for lots of many, many years. And it needs to, so that it would get a bigger impact. And often I leak out information about this group or individual beforehand to prepare the subconscious of the population. You know, like, this group, they have very strange things going on. And maybe they have hidden guns somewhere. Like this. So that when it happens, and right away when the media points at this group, you will say, I know that. I read that somewhere. And you will say right away, yep, I would have accepted so much easier. So they leak this out. And also I prepare evidence, totally fake evidence, that would point straight at this individual or group. So I got the bomb in position, I got the evidence prepared, I got the patsy prepared. This is a totally innocent person that has absolutely nothing to do with it, sometimes even a fake identity. They just have to take the fall, and very often also they get this person killed, suicided there.
Right.
So it's case, thank you folks, go home, have a nice evening. you know, don't even look into this. We've got everything.
We have it under control. Yeah.
Okay. So also, what I do is while I'm preparing this, I set up my own investigation. This is like handpicked people that I control, so that as soon as the bomb goes off or the person is shot or whatever, my investigation goes in and knocks out every normal, honest, decent detective or police officer. So, and their task is only to point they went that way.
Right.
They went that way. And stop people like myself. And also harass normal witnesses, totally disregard normal witnesses, give them a hard time, and then point at the patsy all the time. So that also their job is also to be in touch with media and say, oh my God, it's awful, it's awful, it's awful. We're doing everything we can. We're going to spend millions of your dollars doing absolutely nothing, looking right at all the wrong places and pointing at some weird geeks, including the patsy, because he is the guy. That is how we're going to spend your money. Okay. So when all of that is set up, it's time to blow the bomb. Blow up the bomb. So I have media which I control on quite, I mean, nowadays it's so controlled, it's up in the
absolutely 90s.
It's incredible. So I've got media on standby, and then normally I wait, blowing a bomb in the middle of the night doesn't work, you know, and in the afternoon doesn't even work either. The best thing is in the morning when people are not really awake, they're still a bit emotional, vulnerable. Right. So that the impact can be better. So they're sitting there waiting and they say, okay, now he's just had his coffee, he's reading the newspaper and kiss bye-bye, wife, on my way to the daycare center. So people are on their way to work. So there's a lot of motion going on. That's when they do it. They wait until they got it all set and then, boom, they blow the whole thing up. The building that they blow up is more or less always a building owned by one of their own members. This building will have some kind of problem, structural problem, maybe a crack in the foundation, asbestos, a low rent, problem with not being able to rent out the offices and these type of things. So also you will see that just a few weeks before that, there will be a change in the insurance policy, including terror acts.
Right.
Including the exact thing that will take place. And you will see also on the stock market there will be a sudden rise of some kind of stock options or something else that afterwards, if you track it back, you will see insiders.
Right.
Insiders. How could you know? How could you know? So this is a very good way of tracking down who's behind it. Anyway, so time to blow people up, and 9:15, good time, here we go, boom, off it goes. And they blow up all these beautiful people, it is on stage, and then pump it out in media, all these horrific, awful images of children blown to pieces, blood everywhere, women running around, all of that. Pump it out, pump it out, pump it out, while also you will hear the reporter. They do it very fast nowadays. Problem, oh my God, this has happened. They interview somebody in the payment. Oh, I'm so shocked, it's awful, reaction. And then comes the solution. My God, we need more strict gun control.
Right.
Or in Paris, they said, just minutes after, they said, well, we need a more strict airport control security. What? And that is what they're doing now, airport security up, school security up, all of these things up, 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 for our protection. They're
right.
So careful.
Yeah, go ahead. Traveling in Europe is probably tough now because there's a big list that you have to be on. Isn't that what they implemented as one of the results of the Charlie Hebdo thing?
They try everything to get us into a corner, you know. Shut us in, smaller, smaller, smaller. So they're trying all of these things, and I'm sure I'm going to Sweden the end of this month. I've been invited to do some talks there. It's going to be interesting to see what's going on. It's on the anniversary of the assassination of the Swedish Prime Minister, so I sometimes I take people on a 4 to 5 hour walk around the site of the assassination, just exactly this showing what action happened. It's mind-blowing, I tell you. The official story, a patsy just went, or a lone crazy guy went up, shot one shot, boom, that was it, and run off. I spent like 5 hours there just describing what people actually saw and what was going on. For people who are not aware, which most people are not, they leave where I've seen them walk away like flabbergasted.
Oh, sure. I wish somebody would film that. I wish somebody would film it.
Maybe they will this time, I don't know. For sure. So we're back to the thing.
Yeah, I think. Go ahead.
The bomb is blown up, and right away media says, oh my God, it's the Patsy, and we need this gun control, we need that, we need the war on terror, we need to throw out all the Muslims, we need to, whatever it is right. That they want to push forward. But what is standard is that you will have to pay with loads of money, you will have to accept more and more surveillance, you will have to have more and more militarized police, you will have to accept martial law, you will have to accept being turned upside down in a scanner when you go into the supermarket soon. You will have to accept that you have iris scanners and palm print things. And welcome to sci-fi world. All of these things are based on fake terror. Fake terror. After all of these years, I don't even know if there is such a thing as a real terrorist anymore. Because it's the same thing again and again and again, tracked down to the same small group of
right.
people that are using actors or their own soldiers and people from the Gladio network and so on to carry these things out.
Yeah, Go ahead. I don't want to interrupt you. You're on a roll. I think that you're exactly right. I know that all the wars in the 20th century were started by false flag events. And I can't think of one legitimate terror incident that wasn't orchestrated by, you know, the security agencies.
This is the thing, Pete. We think that they're there to help us, that they're there for our protection. They're absolutely terrorist organization. You know, we really, it would be helpful to just change the name of things, you know, like the White House. If you call it the Satanic House, that would make it more if you call it defense industry, if you call that the slaughter, plunder, rape, and blow up innocent people department, that, you know, it would make it easier. If you call the FBI the federal super criminal investigation unit, the CIA the totally mad mafia murder tool agency. Remember, it's called agency. Because why is it called the CIA? It's an agency that you can rent. These big companies, they go there and they say, listen, we have a problem with this elected leader in this country. We just want to, you know, like bulldoze in, destroy everything, get some hamburgers going here.
Right.
You know, can you help us? We will pay you loads and loads, and you just need to go in and totally massacre the population.
Right.
The agency would say, yeah, no problem. We can do that. And it's an agency for hire. So once you start seeing that all of these terror events in the States, for instance, as far as I know, I don't think I've come across one single one that was not funded, equipped, and trained by the FBI.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. It's like, how is that possible? They're there, and then you see them in films and movies.
I'm from the FBI.
Oh my God, welcome in. Take off your hat, and please, would you like a cup of coffee?
Right.
I would very much say to people who are listening to this, who are either working for the FBI, I'm sure there's a lot of decent, very honest, hardworking people that are there to do the job that they're actually put there to do, to protect us. But there's a core, major core element that is super criminal. And I would, like, if people are listening and you have a an uncle or a father or a brother or a sister who worked for the FBI, the CIA, the NSA, the military, the police, all of these things, please, without being aggressive, question them. Start a debate, see if you can reach the heart of these people, because most of them are so duped into believing that what they're doing is the right thing, that being totally compartmentalized so they don't see the whole picture. But nowadays there's so much information out there, so it's not an excuse anymore, because these are the forces that control the rest of us. The so-called elite, there's so few. There's so few. And we're talking about these, oh, they're so powerful, they have all these high-tech things. I tell you, these old guys, most of them can't even handle a laptop, I'm sure. So when it comes to technique, if we don't do it for them, they're screwed, you know?
Exactly. And so go ahead.
So it's just a matter of take away the tools from them. Stop being their tool of death, because this is what you are. Their agenda is death and destruction, and anyone who helps them forward is part of it.
Right.
It's really is a high time to wake up, because so many people are being hurt and killed, totally innocent people on a daily basis.
Yeah, and if they're there to protect us, and they're as bad at protecting us as they are at staging false flags now. I mean, they're like the Keystone Cops. Remember the Keystone Cops from the old movies? They're bungling into one another. I don't know much about the Ottawa bombing, but I know that one thing that happened in Australia was that the terrorists forgot their flag. And one of their demands was, isn't that hilarious? One of their demands was to get an ISIS flag so that they could have the hostages, quote, hostages, hold it up. And so...
Paul, can I just, for one thing, you know, you had Al-Qaeda. Oh, my God, the boogeyman.
Right.
So awful. Yeah. Al-Qaeda is the name of the CIA's database of agents that they have trained. That they have equipped, that they have used. They built the boogeyman, and then they used them like mercenaries, okay? Then we didn't get scared of that one anymore. So it's almost like you start turning your back, not being afraid, and they say, no, not so fast!
Here's another.
Not so fast! ISIS! Now, this is going to freak you out, because now they dress like Ninja Turtles, and they look very scary, because they've got their own flag, and it's all black like an old pirate flag, so this should scare you.
Right.
Okay. You look at ISIS. This is the official thing. I'm not making these things up. The first leader, I can't remember his name, it was something like Baskadek or something like that.
Al-Kawi, Al-Sawi... I can't remember either.
I can't remember. Anyway, but I'm not sure about the dates either, but it's something like this. He was arrested in 2005. Then he was shot and killed in 2005.
Right.
Then he was released. And then he was behind a car bomb in 2006. And then he was killed in 2007. Okay, I don't know about you, but I would like to know his secret about the, you know, surviving your own death. That's pretty good. He must have been in good condition.
Right.
Then his job was taken over by, and they were like, who can we make up? Should it be like Abdul Mahmoud Bahasna? No, you need somebody that has impact so that people can get brave and start telling their neighbors, oh my God, there's a threat. Who's the threat? It's alcohol. No, it doesn't work. So
right.
He's like a catchy. What can it be? What can it be? Baghdad. Everybody knows that we've blown the crap out of poor Baghdad. Baghdadi. That's the
Baghdadi.
One. I call him Baghdadi. So here comes Baghdadi in on stage. Great. He has the same type of survival rate. You know, he was killed once or twice.
Right.
Came back, escaped. Very good. Then he was killed, poor bugger. Then his role was taken over by another name. Okay, what was that? Baghdadi when we're on a roll, let's just swap the guy, different face, different everything, still by Dadi. And he's still also like, he was shot, he was blown up, and then, as far as I know, he's still alive. But just things like that should make you wake up, you know?
Right.
It's so sloppy. But we buy it because we don't look into it, you know?
Nobody looks into it. Yeah, it seems really strange to me that this strange ISIS group emerges in the Middle East under the nose of Mossad and the CIA and all this. All of a sudden they're there and they're heavily armed and they're, well, you know, that...
And where did they come from?
Where did they come
from? Nowhere. It's pretty amazing.
Right.
And then they have all these chop the head of journalists. I love those. Okay, you got sand and sky, you know, so it's absolutely impossible to see where they are. You know?
Right.
I would say they are in some, I don't know what you call it, dump where you get gravel, something, somewhere like that. Okay. And you got this guy, the body proportions, totally European, not Arabic, you know, he's
right.
Quite tall, muscular, the whole thing. He even has a very strange accent. Oh, we're going like this. And then he's supposed to chop the head of his. The facial structure of the first victims did not fit at all with the journalists they were supposed to be. Now, the latest one, have you seen with the two Japanese guys? Same stage,
right.
The whole thing. And then the shadows are, oh God. You look behind the victims and the shadow goes like this. How can he have that? Only because there are two spotlights on the side. Yeah. And then the wind moves differently in the clothes on the guy on to the right and to the left.
Oh,
and you
no.
almost have like, you know, like when they do green screen, if you don't do
right.
it really good, you have like a bit of an edge to it. And you look here, it looks very much green screen thing. So it's time to wake up. It really is.
It really is. You know, I wonder if the people in Hollywood, since you've had a little bit of experience in that industry, I wonder if the people in Hollywood, like the stars, of course they're totally controlled too, are laughing at this the way you and I are today.
No, I think they're involved. They use Hollywood to get the whole NASA thing going with all the Apollo
shooters.
I mean, nobody cared about these rockets at all until Walt Disney and the Disney whole company came in there. And made this whole, whoa, my God, it's so impressive. This is why we're spending billions of your dollars going out in absolute nowhere, where the rockets can't even reach to, you know, a planet that we're not going to land on, but we're going to put a footstep there, and the flags are going to go like this. It's, you know, so they're using it. And then Boston bombing, I don't know, but there are some photos that looked a lot like Steven Spielberg among the people running around. I don't know. I'm just pointing it out.
Well,
but Hollywood is very controlled by this this group, for sure.
Well,
so I think they're not laughing. I think they're very much in it.
Very much involved in making these... problem, reaction, solutions. I know that they caught, in the Boston bombing, there was one woman who also starred in the false flag Sandy Hook.
She yeah, I know.
Given a different name, but the same woman.
Yeah, they've got loads of these. And I spoke to Chip Tatum, you know, the CIA.
Yes, Chip Tatum.
Who's also been, it's his birthday, Chip.
Oh, happy birthday, Chip.
Happy birthday, Chip. Anyway, so... He has been part of false flag operations, and he says that the reason why they do this is to keep the group as small as possible, to control the group. And I asked him, but how do you do it? He said it's very easy to control people, you know, because people say, how, why wouldn't anyone speak or talk or whatever? Well, the thing is, if you get a million, or $2 million worth of money. I mean, they print them, so it's not a problem at all.
What? No problem.
Pay people. Well, if that doesn't work, you just kill that dog, or you threaten their children. If that doesn't do it, you just kill one of them, and make it very obvious to the rest
right.
of the group that you are next. So you got them by the balls, you know? And I believe that what we're seeing now is almost like they're doing a global tour. I think that they're using the same actors, background actors, like in Sandy Hook, Boston, Sydney, Ottawa. I would very much like to start comparing faces of background people in these different things, because I think they're just like on a rock tour. Let's go. We use the same people. Nobody notices. I mean, who cares? And also in Pakistan, I'm sure that their so-called terrorists there were from the CIA or whoever. You know, they just set it up there. Very easy in a third world country, much easier there than here.
Right.
And you asked about that also several times. So let's go there.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. I don't know much about that. This is going to be interesting.
Okay, you have this thing with two guys coming out to Toyota Corolla, and they're going. It's on this, what is it called, the day with, remember the war victims. With the
Veterans Day or something like that. Like
Veterans Day. What is the red flower?
I don't know.
No, but you know there's this one that symbolizes all the victims that was killed in the First World War and Second World War and so on. Anyway, so you have this car with two people in it, and it's as far as I remember, it's a Toyota Corolla that does a bit of the strange things you've seen in on surveillance cameras and so on. There's some strange movement with police cars as well around that. But there's this war monument, and there are two guards in kilt and uniform. They're standing there, and in the background you've got 1914, 1918, the whole setup for Remember Veterans Day, pro-war, you know, now. We have to unite against the enemy, you know, because war is needed,
right.
That whole state. So this guy jumps out of the car. The second guy, as far as I know, he disappears from the timeline. He was in the beginning, and then they just forget about him. So the car, you know, the second guy, somehow he, oh. So this guy runs off and shoots one of these guards in the quilt. So he goes down, the soldier. And then he jumps into the car, drives off to some parliament building, and go in there, and there's a shootout between a police officer that jumps just like James Bond, you know, he's standing behind a pillar, he jumps up, drops to the floor and shoots him in the foot. Very dramatic. And also, it doesn't matter, that part doesn't matter, I'll just take a little part of it. When you look at the whole thing around the shooting, you will see that there's some, it's been filmed very close up and very far away. The far away one, you will see that the whole crime scene, it has been put with these plastic things.
Oh no.
And no people, no witnesses, no nothing around it. And they're still doing the CPR on this guy. So he's still there. He's only been shot. In a normal situation, you would have loads of people there. Loads of people trying to help or run after the shooter or anything. Here, totally empty. And it's also, the victim is also placed on the side of the monument so that people cannot see from the street. So it's totally, anyway, so he's lying there and some people are doing CPR. As far as I know, when you've been shot in the chest or in the head, not a good idea to give him a good pump like that.
Because right.
That would just get your internal damages would just be... Anyway, so they're doing all of this thing, and afterwards one of the woman who was part of it, because they're being interviewed, and, oh, it was so amazing how we came together as a team, we forgot about the danger and everything, we just did everything we could to help this man, but unfortunately he died. Oh, he was such a good-looking and fun-loving guy. Okay, you tell me, you run up to a victim, and you give him CPR, he dies, and you know that he was fun-loving?
Or that's what you'd mention?
It is the exact words, and she has a little smile, you know, he was such a good-looking and fun-loving guy. Okay. That is one. I mean, these are the things that gives away. Then you look at the people around him, because there's a whole team of normal people,
right?
And then that are helping this victim. They're totally on their own. There's like maybe 50, 100 meters. There's no people around it. And then two bystanders, and they look like what do you call it, bouncers. And you will also often see these bouncers around these false flags, because they're there. If anyone interferes, they're there to just get rid of you.
Right.
Yeah? And you've got these two bouncers, they're just standing around looking like this. One of them has the trainer with a hood on. If you enlarge up, there's a little mark on the hood. If you enlarge it, enlarge it, enlarge it, it's a symbol for the Canadian Army. You know, two names what can I say?
Yeah.
What can I say? Anyway, also, you've got like armed police and so on that have cleared the place. Why do they not clear from the bouncers? They're
right.
Just standing there. They would have been kicked out. You know?
That's amazing.
But these are the things that gives it away.
And then people are aware of that thing called Duper's Delight now, where when they're trying to play like they've just lost their relative and they should be crying and not being able to hold it together, they often are caught laughing. I think it's because they've been paid a lot of money. I think it's a natural tendency. I think that people, normal human beings, have a lot of trouble lying. I don't think it's part of our species to do that easily. So when we're paid to do it, you know, the truth wants to come out, and they start laughing. There's a lot of them from Sandy Hook. The one what's his name? Noah Foster's father?
Yeah.
Robbie Parker's a good example. And then there was one woman on, after her brother was a journalist who was just beheaded, and they were interviewing one of the brothers and then the sister, but the sister just could not keep it together. It was tough for her to stay on the couch and into the conversation. But go ahead.
It's a very good observation. What I normally do is I turn down the sound so I don't listen to them. Uh-huh. And then I just see their facial, also you can see their eye movements when they lie and stuff like that. Their eye, if either they're very, you know, they're aware of that the eyes will move, so they're very,
right.
Like, they stare like this to focus.
Uh-huh.
That's sometimes a sign of lying, but otherwise, very often the eye goes to the left. When just before you lie, the eye goes forward. And these are things that most people cannot control. And this laughing thing is just standard for many of these false flag operations. I don't know why. I mean, get some skilled people, you know, because, but these are amateurs. They need to be amateurs, so they can't be tracked back as actors. So I think this is a problem they have.
Right. They've got to get some more talented people.
Yeah.
And also, yeah. I noticed in the Australia shooting, the camera work was done in a real fuzzy camera, so that you really couldn't pick things out. I think they're starting to use that technique where, you know, we're saying that this is what happened and this is what was going on, but you really can't tell, you really can't analyze it because it was shot from a fuzzy camera.
They're trying to avoid people like myself to give away too much, so the more they can shake, oh my God, it's so authentic.
Right.
And it also makes it so more difficult for someone like myself. But I would say, when you look at all these things, the Ottawa, the Sydney, the Paris and so on, where are all the normal footage from normal people? I mean, nowadays, everybody has got a mobile camera. Why don't we see any films like that? Where are they? You know, we always see these same official ones again and again and again. There should have been hundreds of them on the internet.
Exactly. I guess they're cleansed. Or
and also, there's another thing, you know, with the Sandy Hook, Boston, and so on. And on big film sets, when you've got a big crew, one of the things that they do sometimes is they give like a what do you call it, not a bracelet, but a badge on a thing around your neck. And often it's with color code, so that like, okay, we got the people from the fire station, everybody in the red team, yeah, hands up. Okay, you go over there, the green team stays there. Now the time to eat, the yellow team can eat while we do the next shoot and so on. It's when they got a lot of people around. And they, if you see in Boston, in the Sandy Hook, I saw it at the Bilderberg meeting in Copenhagen, where inside the hotel where they were so-called Bilderbergers, these people that I did not recognize had the same tag around there. And then they also were shooting same tags. And you will see there's one thing where they filmed that these two heavily armed soldiers that are standing outside an entrance to an office. I would say if there's a mad shooter outside, stay indoors until it's over and put some guards outside maybe.
Right.
But stay indoors. Don't go home. You can wait. You know, your supper can wait. You know,
right.
Stay there. But here, you've got two armed soldiers. It looks very dramatic. And they're letting out, I don't know how many people are coming out from this door. And more or less, all of them have this thing around their neck.
Wow. It seems to me when I would hear shooting, now I don't have any military background at all, but I would hit the ground. Seems to
yeah.
me the first thing I would do is just get as flat as I could to be less of a target. But
you know, the Woolwich beheading? Do you remember that one?
Which beheading?
Yeah, the beheading in Woolwich, where they chopped the head off a soldier called Rigby, Lee Rigby.
Roughly, yeah, I roughly remember.
Oh, I love it. I love it. It's my all-time favorite. It is so bad. Two black guys who said to they were so upset because they saw this guy with a t-shirt that said Help for Heroes, so they drove and knocked him over the car, then jumped out of the car, took a big cleaver and a knife and chopped the head of this guy, pulled him out in the middle of the street, and then was standing being interviewed by somebody who has never been identified and saying, we're sorry that people had to see this, but we had to experience things like this every day in our home country, you know, where people are being slow societies and all this. And anyway, after 25 minutes, the police comes, shoots them down. 25 minutes, it's only central London, okay, so maybe they were a bit slow that day, the English police and so on. But you look at the background action, it's just outside a major, the Royal Artillery Barracks, major army installation. It takes 25 minutes or 30 minutes, the whole thing. Does anyone come out and approach these guys? No. So it's just your body that is lying here without a head.
So,
I mean, you should think maybe someone would just pay attention. And then the street is closed off. There's no traffic. You can see traffic moving in the background, but it's been closed off. How has it been closed off? When you have big film scenes like this, you normally have like one or two buses of extras. Okay, and then for some reason, the trucks that they drive, the equipment, the lighting, the makeup, the uniforms, dress, everything like that, makeup studio, are normally white trucks. I don't know why they're white, but all the ones that I've seen are white. And then they come on site and they just pull the sides out of the truck and you got the whole thing ready, you know. So it's very, very convenient. And then when everything is there, all the extras have been, the makeup has been done, clothes, all of these things, then the director comes, normally quite late, and he comes in a private car or a cab. You check out the vehicles on site for this thing. There are two buses, one blocking the traffic from one side, the other one blocking from the other side. Extras, two buses. Then you have a white truck, equipment, lighting, all of these things, that blocks off the side street. Yeah, it's part, so it blocks off the road. And then to block off the traffic totally on the upper side is a cab. The exact same vehicles that would be there had there been a film shoot. But then the reason I mention this is because in the background, I love this, I love it. You have this guy, he's standing, they've done two takes, one with blood, one without blood, and then they had major problems explaining why he didn't have blood on his hand, on one of them and on the other one. Anyway, so he's standing there with a big cleaver and a massive knife, blotted like this, and talking about this poor headless guy who's in the middle of the street. Then in the background, you see these women coming with a little trolley on the way home from the supermarket. And four of them just walked by him. They walked right by him. I don't know about you, Paul, but if I had seen somebody chop the head of someone, I would be somewhat upset, you know, maybe shaken. And maybe I would avoid the guy with a knife. But these people, they walked right by him. He's standing there with bloody knives, all of these things. It's wonderful.
And they stood there. And they stood for 25 minutes waiting for the military to get there, the police?
Yeah. The whole thing is so staged. And then, you know, you look at the car when it said to knock him over and then crashed up again upon a signpost. You look at the signpost, they're constructed to, if there's an impact, they will fold right away that it won't damage the less damage possible. This stands like this, there's not a scratch on it, and the car is totally smashed in the front. Not the impact you would see if you hit a pedestrian, because normally if you hit a pedestrian, it would hit him over the legs, and then the windshield would be the major impact. Nothing like that on this. The airbags, the airbags has not exploded, even though the impact is so hard. And then there's no blood in front of the car where they chopped the head off the guy, until in the afternoon when people started pointing it out, and suddenly there's a big puddle of blood there, And I just want to go back to the past thing. You have the BBC reporter there as well. He's standing some hours after this happened. I would also say where the police officer was shot and where the blood was later found is not the same position. It was like a meter. There's a signpost where you can measure from. It's not where his head was. And you see when he's being put on the stretcher, no blood, nowhere. And by the way, this guy was a Muslim, the police officer, so why did they shoot him if they were so upset?
Yeah.
But anyway, you have this BBC reporter, and he stands, we're standing here at the side where this awful thing happened. My God, it's a tragedy. And then behind us, there are some candles and some flowers. There's so little, because people, I think, are waking up, so they're not buying it anymore. You know, when Ole Palmer was shot, there were roses like meters of them. Here, 5-6 roses put down there by the people who staged the whole event, I think. And then he says, and here you can see the blood that was put on the pavement. That's his words, the blood that was put on the pavement. And then you look at the blood, because they officially tried to wash it off. It's like 3-4 square meters. First no blood, and then like so much. So I would give it a high rating.
No, I think that it's interesting. I think the flower phenomenon after these events, especially the Charlie Hebdo thing, to get, you know, the florists work on supply and demand, so they don't order more flowers than they're going to sell because they're perishable. So how did all these Parisian florists get access to these millions and millions of flowers on such a short notice? I mean, it happened the next day.
Paul.
I'm sorry.
Intelligent man. You're an intelligent man. I love your way of observing, because this is the whole thing. When the Swedish Prime Minister was shot, because this was a staged event as well, they, as far as I know, they had all the posters with his photo with a black ribbon. Everything was prepared. And here we see it again. Charlie, jump. And I've been almost like a slander campaign from where I come from, my own hometown, where they think, boycott me because I'm just pointing these things out. How can you do a thing like that? Think of the families of the victims. I am thinking of the families of the so-called victims, of innocent people, not these people, because it's not even real. And one thing with a I'm sorry if I jump the...
No, go ahead. I'm loving it.
The London thing, I just want to point out also that the thing was, it was the first year, it was 2013, end of May, just when the first Bilderberg meeting ever was going to be held officially, because they tried to deny that the AMEN existed for so many years, and then they couldn't do it anymore, so instead they invited the first to Watford outside London, or invited them. They were invited in a fenced-in area, 1 kilometer from the hotel, with police cars and helicopters, everything. So I wouldn't really call it an open meeting. Nobody was allowed in anywhere near. But anyway, I would say that the international media was like, are you kidding me? Does this group really exist? Is it possible? So they were sort of packing their bags, and then boom, happened the beheading in Woolwich. And suddenly the whole attention was pulled. Media globally looked left, you know. So everybody was focusing on this awful thing, blamed on Muslims. And then you had the whole thing with some people were writing in pig's blood on mosques and all of these things. This is part of it as well. People have to understand that these riots are also part of it. It's provocateurs that go in and just get the fire going.
That's right.
So there's different steps to the whole thing.
Yeah, we've just heard here that George Soros had a lot to do with financing the Ferguson riots. You know, he was not only involved with the Ukraine upset, but he's putting money into that. So we know that these things are staged for. Let's hope they're staged for the Grand Awakening. Let's hope that the reason that they're doing this is like what you said in the beginning. They're going to wake us up. Go ahead.
No, but their intention is totally different. It's up to us what we make of it. And I think let's use it to wake up. Let's use it to become open the eyes, just like you. I love the way the observations you made about these things. Beautiful, because that shows you like, whoop, wait a second. I'm not going to buy this before I check it out for myself. And then just use what I call normal found ground logic. Look at it. Real events, and the truth is very simple. You don't have to do anything with the truth. If a thing happened, it happened.
Right.
If somebody said the truth, there's nothing to hide. The truth, as I said before, does not fear investigation. But these things do, big time.
Right.
And the more people involved, the more trickier it is. And Chip Tatum, I spoke to him about these things, and he said, keep it going, because every time we disturb their timeline, he said when he was in this, it messed it up for months and months and months when the timeline was disturbed. You know, when something unexpectedly happened, it really messed it up. So let's mess it up, folks. That's what I say. Let's mess it up. But as soon as you hear about a drill somewhere nearby where you live or anything like that, go down there. Bring your mobile cameras, video cameras. It will look like a film set or strange vehicles. Film them. Make it very, very, very obvious that they're being filmed, you know. And then let's be one step ahead so that we can say, you know, so that if they, before they even think about pulling a trigger or blowing up a bomb, they have to stop it, you know. We've been exposed. We have to pull back. And, I did a thing like that in Copenhagen, I believe, and managed to stop a massacre there. And just a few weeks ago, after the Paris Hebdo, I was sent a very eerie image that had been published on Ireland. I don't know by who, but it says, it was like four photos put together, and it said, Israel now, Dublin next, and then with a bomb. And then Israel now, Paris next, with a bomb, and the Eiffel Tower. Then it was Copenhagen, Israel now, Copenhagen, with a little mermaid and a bomb. And then Italy, with a bomb, Israel. I thought that was pretty scary, because I've seen, as far as I know, there was a bomb scare in Dublin, then came Paris, And then I was contacted by a man who heard me on radio talking about these templates and drills. And he said he just walked by a poster in central Copenhagen where it says that they were going to have a major drill in one of the train stations, one of the main train stations in central Copenhagen, the night between the 14th and the 15th of January. He said, could this be one of the things that you were talking about? I said, yes, thank you, thank you, thank you. So I went out big time saying to people in Denmark, please, please go there, bring your cameras, bring your friends, bring your picnic basket, you know, bring your sleeping bags, and just make it so obvious to these people that they're being observed. Maybe it's a drill for our protection, maybe it's not. The main thing is nothing happened. You know, there was nothing happened. So, who knows? Maybe in the future we will find out that, yeah, this was planned. But if it was planned, and we screwed it up. Do you know this thing in Copenhagen, outside the Bilderberg meeting? I spoke to a guy afterwards, and also Chip said that a thing like that can really mess it up globally for them on the time scale, because they had put such an emphasis on creating a massive impact there, and then the steps that would follow was from this thing. And then if that didn't happen, then all of this went down the drain, and they had to regroup. And so,
right,
there's a wonderful thing, you know, with dominoes, you know, the domino effect. That the formula is that a falling domino can knock over a domino 1.5 its own size. Okay, that's the whole thing. And I saw this thing where they started with a domino. It was 1 millimeter thick and 5 millimeter high, and they went 13 steps. But they said if they had gone 29 steps, that little one that turned over would have turned over the Empire State Building.
Wow.
So I'm just saying, maybe you think that you're powerless. Think of that. Think of that and the effect spreading out.
Right.
The effect of these type of programs, the effect of you speaking to your neighbors in a loving way. Don't push it on them.
Right.
Don't, because if you freak people out, you will just add to their agenda. We need to stay out of fear and just stay in love and focus it on exposing. Focus on it and totally non-violently expose these things to make them stop.
Exactly. You know, that's what I love about the interviews with you, because it always ends on positive. It's always uplifting. And even though it gets into some technical details, it always comes back to treat them with love, treat them with respect, understand what they're going through, because we're all going through this awakening thing, and it's not easy for anybody. So that's about all the time we have. Ole, I can't get over how much I love these talks and how informative they are. I mean, this is really going to, I think, awaken a lot of people. Just talking about how you see things and how, you know, how it's a positive thing. It's like we have a choice. A false flag is coming. Are we going to use it to our development, or are we going to go into fear? You know, I think that's the bottom line here. Thanks. Do you have anything else to say at the end here, Ole?
I sure have.
Okay.
One thing that is so important to be aware of, that dangers are real. Some things are dangerous. You know, if you stand on the edge of a cliff, it's not very clever to take a step out into the thin air. There are such things as dangers. But fear is only in the mind. It is only something in the mind, and it's about something that has not yet happened. Even if somebody's pointing a gun at you, as long as he doesn't pull the trigger, you're fine. It is, your fear is about something that might happen. And this is where you can also learn to control it. So the more I would suggest, humbly suggest, the more you can stay focused on love, stay focused without criticism on your fellow human being, without the intention of fighting or quarreling or any, but with the intention of adding to this world the beautiful ingredients of love. That is the way that, that this will move forward. So whatever the situation is, whatever the situation is, meet it with a higher frequency. And the closer you can get to love, the better the result. And if nothing else, you will start seeing your life around you will start blossoming. The people around you will start relaxing, will start becoming more friendly, will start listening to you as well. Because people who are very much into these conspiracies are very often so obsessed with the, right. with the dark, 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 that people are, other people are just like, oh God, shut up, I can't have it, you know, right. it's too much. So you need to live by example and wait for, knock on the door and wait for them to open it. If they don't open it, then don't try right. to force it in. You know, go somewhere else. And I would say mainly focus on changing the person in the mirror. That's the only one that you can really do a difference with. But when you do that, it comes out beautifully. You know? So focus on do good, be good. There's nothing wimpy about being good. You know? Now you should be a badass, or you should be a this or that. Absolutely not. It's their design. It is by design to destabilize beautiful things like honor and integrity and these things. Do you think it's just by coincidence that beautiful woman walks around with a t-shirt where it says whore? Or, you know, like, it's like so twisted. And it's done by design. We've gone so off the road. So we need to go back and ask ourselves, because in your heart you know these things. You know what is good, you know what is bad, you know what is right, you know what is wrong. And go the honorable way. These people have totally corrupted the world. And it said that, you know, like corruption comes from above. I say let's integrity come from below. Let's build it up totally on honesty, transparency, integrity, compassion, forgiveness, do all of these things from the bottom up, so that we would just, these people will not be able to continue. It's been in the old days, it was like, you should be a man of honor, you should stand by your word, and your word should really count, you should do your duties and these things. But then, when the top became so corrupt, then everybody says, well, screw this, you know, like right. if they can do this, then I can do as well. But the thing that would happen is that we destroyed society ourselves, so we need to build up again.
Exactly.
And I apologize if I use not so nice words sometimes, it's not my intention. But can I end with a prayer?
Yes, that would be great, Ole. Go ahead, let's do that.
It's my beautiful, beautiful Raja Yoga teacher, Melanie Chelan, that often ends with this when it goes like this.
Okay.
May the entire universe be filled with peace and joy, love and light. May everyone, and especially the ones who hurt us, be filled with peace and joy, love and light. Victory to that love.
Thank you very much. And we'll say goodbye now. Have a wonderful evening, and we'll talk to you maybe next month. I'd love to talk to you after you get back from Sweden, because I'm really interested to find out what you see there.
For sure. I would very much love to do this on a regular basis, because I think it is what happens between us. Do you know the word synergy?
Yeah, synergy.
Where it's like you got the parts on a torch or a lamp or something like that. You got a battery, you got a spring, you got a bulb. And think, each on their own doesn't really do a lot, but when you put them together, then suddenly, boom, magic happens.
Right.
And I think when we meet like this, something bigger than us happens. So I'm very happy to be part of this.
Yeah, so are we. So thank you very much.